Hello, welcome to the third official podcast. I'm Nick Weymouth, Head of Digital for Queen Productions Limited. This time round, we'll be chatting to my friend, esteemed colleague, and all-round good guy, Greg Brooks. We discuss Genesis, we also discuss Kate Bush, and also Tori Amos, plus Greg's interesting time that he had with Jeff Wayne and the War of the Worlds soundtrack. I hope you enjoy it, and we'll catch up with you next time.
Some of you may well know Greg, or have come across him, or you've spoken to him.
Abused me.
The majority of you probably have.
Some of them, people
listening. He needs it.
Some of the people listening to this may even have sent me death threats, Nick.
Here's hoping. Greg Brooks, Queen Archivist, what do you do? Where do you sit in this mighty Queen Productions family?
Generally, I was employed to be the archivist, and that covers an awful lot of ground and has grown and grown and grown, because not only is it audio tapes now in all their various forms, it's video as well and film. So generally speaking, I look after all the film that comes in, all the video, because we've gathered everything around the world that we know to exist.
And you continue to do so.
Yeah, all the time. We recall things, we ask people, have you got any Queen stuff in your basement? Have you? Right, send it to me at this address. And then I log them in the database.
So these are collectors you might speak to?
Not collectors. This is professional format audio.
People that, where you've known things have been filmed or
Electra
recorded?
Electra Records in the States.
Right,
or it could be ATV television company,
right, gotcha.
In Birmingham.
So actual setups that you know.
Whoever has had reason to have a Queen audio or video item in the last 40 years, we try and get them all sent back. And I deal with them, log them, sort them, photograph them. Make sure they're in good condition. Make sure that if it's filmed, that it's not got vinegar syndrome and it's going to infect all the other items.
What is vinegar syndrome?
Well, a celluloid film item, if it's past a certain age, it can get what they call vinegar syndrome. So you open the can, the metal can, and you smell vinegar, and you know you're in trouble. And what's more, if you leave that item with the other film, it will infect it.
Right.
Just like a virus, you know, or bacteria. So we look after the health, if you like, the welfare of these type tapes. We keep them in the right temperature. We make sure there's no mould spores on them, and there's no damp on the cardboard, or there's nothing on the piece of paper inside that can contaminate the tape.
So you're a cleaner, basically, yeah?
I could be a cleaner. I get my Ajax.
Get spray down.
I take the Bohemian Rhapsody multitrack and I get my Brillo pad. Yeah. But anyway,
so these all sit in one place, do they? We're not really reveal where the secret bunker is,
no.
But you know, they're all in one place.
So you have all the audio and all the video, similar location, but you don't keep the masters in the same place as the safety copies, for obvious reasons. So we keep them apart, we look after them, we make sure that we don't send masters out. If somebody wants Bohemian Rhapsody for their TV ad in Japan, we make a copy and we send them a copy. Thereafter, I look after Brian's personal memorabilia, his clothes, his, you know, his Queen
costume.
He keeps
everything, doesn't he? He's kept everything,
thank goodness he did. So not only the records and the vinyl and the acetates and the cassettes, but the T-shirts, the costume, the awards, the posters. All those need to be logged, and you need to know where you can find these things. It's all very well.
So that's
looking.
Brian's personal archive. Doubles up as Queen's hall of assets for product and all that sort of thing.
I also look after the Freddie, part of the, most of the Freddie archive, actually.
Right.
Most of the audio and about half the video. The safeties, the masters of Freddie's video are elsewhere. And then, in addition to that, we have product that we're always working on. We might be working on a website or Roger's stuff or Freddie's things.
So we sit in our Queen team meetings and we say, right, we are going to release X.
Let's say Rainbow.
So everyone jumps into
Rainbow mode.
Particular little Rainbow mode. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
There, little. And so for you, how does that start for you? Where do you?
Okay, the first thing I would do is go to the database and look in the audio and call up all the Rainbow, whether it is an old cassette, it could be an old Brian cassette. I found a cassette recently which Brian's mum had recorded at the Rainbow on the first night in November.
She was a bootlegger.
She bootlegged
what?
It.
What? So it could be out there, and Brian May's mum.
No, in fact, it's not out there. It's never been anywhere. Brian's mum, bless her, she must have taken a little machine in her handbag. She must have. What's that word? Smuggled it in.
Well, you're not going to frisk Mrs. May, are you?
But the nice thing is that okay, we've already got the audio for that show.
Yeah, sure.
On multitrack, that's not going to be bettered. But she left the tape running, and you heard her chatting to her husband. And later, she did a little message to Brian, who'd obviously arranged for his parents to be at that show. And that is a lovely, priceless, unique gem.
Indeed, yeah.
So things like that may be relevant to Rainbow. So anyway, I would gather together not just the multi-tracks masters. It could be a cassette, it could be an old U-matic that might possibly have something that nobody knows existed, and then I would give them all to Justin and Chris and say that's everything that I know to exist for Rainbow,
and they will sift through it and
they'll go through
clean
it
up or
transfer it, listen through it. Chris will go through it to the nth degree, listening to every second of every track on every tape.
Wow.
So people don't know this stuff.
People don't see this is the detail.
The detail that these guys go into is unbelievable. Yeah. So I gather all together the audio and the video, and then I'll speak to Richard Gray about photographs, and maybe Jim Beach about text or sleeve notes, memorabilia that might be relevant to it.
Do you check in with any experts or facts that need verifying or anything like that?
Yeah, I liaise with Gary Taylor quite a bit.
Gary, yes.
He works with me because he's got an eagle eye for a detail. And I'm not bad myself, but it's that old thing about 40 years down the line or 35 years down the line, you do tend to forget the odd thing. And Gary will come in and say, oh, don't forget such and such. And you think, oh yeah, that's right, that's relevant. So I like to think that between myself and Gary and the team, Justin, Chris, Richard.
Me? Well, me. And that bloke, I wasn't there, but
that Weymouth bloke. Between the lot of us, we generally get it all covered. And by the time we've put a project to bed, word has invariably leaked out to the fans, and the fans will sometimes write to me or to Chris or somebody or Nick or Gary and say, don't forget, guys, you haven't overlooked that, have you, that point, or that so-and-so has got that photograph. And right. Okay, well, what about that interview? So I think generally we gather all the right elements. It doesn't necessarily always follow that everything makes the final product.
For sure, no, yeah.
But you can rest assured that everything has at least been considered.
All avenues
sometimes,
have been in,
sometimes people say, oh, Budapest came out and that wasn't on it. Don't these guys know anything? Why didn't anybody think of that? Well, the chances are we did think of it. We thought of 100 things that you didn't think of and more, but for whatever reason, they got overruled or the band didn't like that detail or for a legal reason we couldn't use that, or for a copyright reason we couldn't use that. All those things are relevant. All I'm doing as an archivist is gathering all the elements, putting them on the table and saying, this is what we've got, you decide if we use them.
Yeah.
It's not my decision, it's Roger,
no,
Brian,
absolutely.
John, Jim,
no.
Who decide, ultimately, that they make the big decisions.
No, but it's clearly your position is actually a lot more involved than some people think. I mean, like I said, I think some people think that you literally sit around just listening to outtakes and demos and songs that we've never heard before, chuckling to yourself, thinking, oh, can't wait till these get released. But I mean, it happens. But
on that subject, because it is a very interesting subject and the thing I get asked the most.
Yeah.
When I first came into the family, as you called it, when I was first employed, this is 15 years ago now, I did listen to all the outtakes.
Queen outtakes.
All the Queen outtakes.
Because your first main job was the...
to log all that stuff.
That part of your job would have been very much used in regards to the reissues we did. Where we had the
Absolutely.
DVDs,
when
we
did the remasters with Universal and they wanted bonus material, we definitely went all through my notes and pinpointed certain things, which saves you countless weeks and months of going... We didn't have to go back through every tape again. We went back to my notes... And then Justin and I listened to 100 items instead of 10,000 items. And then we whittled it down to the stuff that Justin would know is good enough for Brian and Roger and John to hear.
I love hearing feelings.
Yeah,
that was great.
Yeah.
and what was the other thing?
Whole load of good
stealing.
Stuff.
Stealing. Was it stealing?
We didn't use stealing. We did sail away to its sister, and I can't remember what we did for the Miracle, actually, off the top of my head. But generally speaking, there were all kinds of great things, what I would regard as great. Justin would automatically know there's no way Roger will okay that, or Brian will not okay that. Let's not even waste their time. Okay, fine. So then we go back to them with a short list, play them some stuff, and that's what got through is what you get on those remasters.
Yeah. I think one of the main things that you'll remember for at the moment is the fantastic Freddy box set.
I know it was kind of
12, 13 years ago. It was one of the first things I was actually given when I started to work for the Queen. It was phenomenal. I've never seen anything like it. I mean, I know it's slightly different in Freddie's state. It's not Queen, and there's, you know, it's a different way of working.
No, I hope people think of it like that, because I do as well.
And I mean, we would all love to see a similar Queen things, wouldn't we, in that sort of sense?
Again, this is the other thing that I get asked the most. The thing is, with the Freddie box, it didn't have to... Everything on there didn't, audio-wise at least, didn't have to be approved by Roger and Roger, John and Brian, like a Queen thing would be. So we put a whole load of stuff together, Justin and I, and Chris was around at that time as well. I went right through the entire archive and came up with a short list, or a medium-sized list. Justin whittled it down to a small list, albeit... I think it was over 100 items.
A small, large list.
Yeah, it was quite a big thing, and I think it's a pretty impressive body of work. That
things like Reese's documentary and the Days of Our Lives DVD. Are you kind of a reference point guy?
Oh,
for
absolutely.
That?
The Days of Our Lives, and was it called The Great Pretender? Yes. In the end, it was called something else at the start. Both of those things required several hundred tapes, video items from the archive. I was constantly, every day, sending new boxes of stuff for that documentary.
Yeah, no, they both came out really well.
I'd forgotten how much, only when they'd finished working on it and they all came back, nearly 400 items. Well, if you're dealing with the amount of tapes we are, I mean, I'm not dealing with 200 audio and 160 video.
Yeah.
It's getting on for 13,000 items. So you have to keep close tabs. You have to know what's what, where it is, what condition it's in. Has it got a copy?
It's great that Queen have got her in this position, obviously, because, you know, Queen are in a situation where they own their own songs as well. And you often read that, you know, things are found somewhere in boot sales or all that sort of thing. But people didn't know all those years ago, necessarily, that there would be any worth in the future in things that have been filmed or things that have been recorded. Because you hear the horror stories of the BBC... just lobbing out tapes of sessions of all sorts of bands and we need the tapes, you know.
20, 30 years ago, people generally didn't seem to realise the value or the worth in their archive. But probably not really the case with Queen. I'm sure that all the band, and Jim Beach especially, I'm sure they must have had more than half an eye on let's retain all our tapes and keep them, because it costs money to keep your tapes in a lock-up and store them. So they must have made a decision that we're going to keep these because they probably will have value in down the line.
I guess if you are at a certain level, you might think, without sounding too big-headed, we are making history here in a sense.
No, well,
if you
like
get to a certain
so.
Level, you know there's a certain popularity and therefore you've maintained a certain amount of interest over a certain amount of years. So you maybe, like I said, you have one eye on, well, you know, this has got something in this, isn't there? I mean, when rock and roll, you know, kicked off, it was all supposed to be a disposable thing, wasn't it? That it was just pop music spat out. It won't last that long.
Don't you
think? Rock around the clock. Thanks very much.
I think it's, let's face it, if you were in the studio in 75, recording A Night at the Opera onto a multi-track tape with Freddie and all the rest of them, you have to know that these are valuable items and that you've got to look after them and you've got to keep them. You might not know that 30 or 40 years down the line, you're going to be dealing with a new record label that want to put your entire back catalogue out again with all remastered gems.
For sure.
You're not a mind reader.
No,
you haven't got a crystal ball, but it must have been likely that these things had a life beyond the album of the day.
What did you do before you worked for Queen? Who did you work for?
Immediately before Queen, I took a temporary job running a fireplace shop.
Excellent.
And the guy, my partner and I, Jan, we needed a fireplace. So we got this guy, local chap came round, and he was in dire straits. He really needed a manager of his shop, and I really needed a job.
Right.
And we helped each other out. It was a really
What did
lucky...
you know about fireplaces?
Oh, nothing. After the year I'd worked there, I still knew nothing. I knew...
That's funny, he's not even a Queen fan
honestly,
either, bizarrely. Yeah.
Honestly,
yeah.
I knew nothing. I just took all the calls and did this job as best I could. Helped him out of a hole. He helped me out of a hole. Brilliant. And then before that job happened, I'd had an interview for the Queen job. In 95, I had my interview with Queen.
Oh, right.
During the making of Made in Heaven. Although, as that album was finishing, I was being interviewed in London at Pembridge Road by Jim and Julie Glover. And then they said, right, okay, we will hire you, but not yet. We've got to wait a while. And that while turned out to be a year and a half.
Wow. You needed a lot of checking out, didn't you?
I tell you,
you got a lot of skeletons in your closet.
The entire time that I was in the fireplace shop, every time the phone rang, I was hoping it was Jim. And it never was. Until a year and a half, and suddenly it was.
How funny.
But honestly, the whole time I worked in the fireplace shop, I thought I'd be doing that job a month or 6 weeks.
Yeah, but you enjoyed it so much.
Oh, it was dull.
Cleaning chimneys. War of the Worlds, I know about this. Some people might not know about this, but a slight tangent here, but
you've
got something to do with that, haven't you?
Just before the Queen job came in, or about 8 months before the Queen job came up, as Queen fans will know, I've always written record collector articles on Queen for Record Collector magazine, right?
Mm-hmm.
And one of my favourite albums was Geoff Wayne's War of the Worlds. So I got in touch with his office, found out that by pure chance he lived near me.
You were stalking him, right?
About 40 minutes up the road.
Right.
Shut up. So anyway, I went to see Jeff to do this article. And
how do you just go and see Jeff? You know.
Well,
like
I rang his office, and then he rang me and said, I understand you want to do an article on my album. I said, yes.
Oh, okay. So
he said, where do you live? I said, Hertfordshire. He said, so do I. Come and see me.
Right.
Went to see him, had a good chat. We liked each other. That article turned into a book. We wrote a book together, which never got published, but that's another story. It was a good book, actually. It's a shame. But anyway, Jeff and I got...
Like all your other books that might come out in the future.
So, Jeff and I got on well. I loved his album. We chatted, and he asked me what I was doing. In fact, I must have started work for Queen by then, because I'd already done about 6 months' work. And then he said, oh, I need somebody to sort out my War of the Worlds tapes. Would you consider it? I said, absolutely. So I used to do a day a week for him. I ended up working with Jeff for 7 years.
Yeah.
And loved it, because he's a nice guy and brilliant musician, and I love the album. But then towards the end of it, it all went a bit sour when he took somebody else on. Not as an archivist, he took somebody else on in his company to run his company, who was... an unorthodox guy.
But your Queen stuff must have been
ramping
up.
Didn't get on with him. Well, no, it was ramping up. Queen was getting busier and busier, but I still would have continued to work with Jeff.
Right, okay.
If it had just been Jeff, but when he took this other idiot on, I thought, I can't work with this guy. Nobody in the universe can work with this other guy. So various people left Jeff's employ, including me. And it's regrettable, because I do like Jeff. I think he's a good guy. And I enjoyed the War of the Worlds and the people that I met there, but it became intolerable, and now we don't talk, we don't see each other.
Oh, that's a shame.
But that was good. 7 years we did that in parallel with Queen.
Oh, okay.
So two of my greatest passions in music, well, number one is Queen, and probably number two would probably have been the War of the Worlds and Kate Bush. So I worked for two of the three, can't be bad.
Well, interestingly, another Queen team member, Richard Gray, he used to take photos of Kate Bush, didn't he? Early album sleeves, I must say.
The second album, worked on the Lionheart album.
Yeah, I remember him saying to me once, he was saying that, you know, she's a phenomenal artist, she's a lovely girl, and he said the world literally was at her feet, but she was just, she was that smart then, she just didn't want all that pressure, she never wanted the whole fame thing. She said, you know, I'll release records when I want and how
Absolutely.
I want. You know, I know she had a contract, but she was very, very, very focused then, I think, on what she wanted to get out of life, not just out of what she
I mean, I would put her in a similar league to Queen, because I think she's an absolute genius and a phenomenal musician and songwriter. And the only other person I could have worked for 24/7, the hours that I do for Queen and enjoy as much as I do with Queen, would have been Kate. I think she's fantastic.
We are deviating somewhat, but I remember we had a chat a couple of weeks ago, and one of your claim to fame is in fact that Tori Amos wrote a song about you.
Apparently,
is that
yes.
true?
It is true.
It really true?
It is true.
At first, I had no idea whether you were pulling my leg or not.
But. Yes, no, it is true, and I don't tell people that because largely they think I'm lying. But I did I co-wrote a record collector article in.
I think you said you co-wrote the song. At that
no,
point.
No. In 1993 or 1994, I did this article on Tori Amos with a friend of mine at the time, a Tori Amos expert, and we went to. It's vague, my memory. I've got a shocking memory. We went to interview.
Said the archivist.
We went to have a chat with her at Cambridge Corn Exchange, I think it was, before we saw
good
the
venue,
show.
Good
and venue. We had a chat with her, had a good chat, and she was fine. And we, certain parts of her private life, she's got some bad things happen
yes,
to
yeah.
her. And Robin and I, we wrote this thing, and we dealt with it in quite a sensitive way. And she was impressed. She liked it because other people had clumsily written about it. Because she was attacked and all kinds of awful things. Anyway, on the back of that, I met her, and I remember talking about my CD collection and writing. I was quite a prolific letter writer then, back in the day when you wrote letters as opposed to emails. And then she wrote this song, A Pretty Good Year.
So there you go. Think of Greg Brooks when you listen to that song.
It's
I
a good
haven't ruined
song.
It for you.
But the line is something like, Greg, he writes letters and plays his CDs, blah, 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 blah.
It's funny, this is supposed to be a Queen podcast, but it's...
That's all right, it's all a bit of background.
I mean, what's... I mean, you know...
Tori Amos, by the way.
Yeah.
For people who are listening, if you don't know Tori Amos, check out the first album, which is phenomenally good.
It's a Little Earthquakes.
It's absolutely brilliant. Listen to it on good speakers and do the same with the first three Kate Bush albums.
Mm. So what sort of stuff are you listening to at the moment? I mean, you know, what was in the car yesterday or whatever you're doing?
Genesis, Duke, my favourite Genesis album.
Oh, really?
We've Turn It On Again.
That's Phil Collins' era,
Duchess.
Isn't it?
Oh, brilliant
yeah,
album.
Yeah, I've got to be honest, I'm not much of a Genesis fan. So
well, that's a great album.
Yeah.
And Trick of the Tail, I love. What have I been
that's
listening
Gabriel,
to
isn't it?
No.
Is it?
No,
is it not?
No, that's I think
early,
the first
early,
album
yeah,
after he
yeah,
left. Just
yeah.
the three of them. The first yeah. album... The second album with three of them. I listen to AC/DC a lot.
You know what? AC/DC should be on the National Health. If you want to feel good, you listen to AC/DC. Mm. Seriously. Mm. I mean, I probably listen to more AC/DC than anyone, really. And I'm a huge Queen Stones fan. And I think... I know it all. Everyone says, it all sounds the same. But I just can't stop grinning when you put AC/DC on.
Right.
Really.
No.
It's just the groove. Thanks very much. It's what we do. Like it
there is
just phenomenal. Brian's a big fan, isn't he?
He loves
AC/DC.
Absolutely. But despite what so many people say, of my generation anyway, they say, there's no good music anymore, and there's no... But there's tons and tons of phenomenally good music out there. If you listen to Bob Harris on Saturday night on
Whispering
Radio 2...
Bob Harris.
Whispering Bob.
We've got stuff with him. Queen have got stuff with him.
He will...
The archive, haven't they?
On a Saturday night, he will play phenomenal things that you need to go and listen to... Bye.
Isn't it all Americana kind of country?
No, is it Eckerslake? No.
I thought he did it. He did
everything. He plays a lot of American stuff. He'll play English folk. He'll play anything that's remotely good. And most of his show is brilliant. To my taste, 99% of what he plays is phenomenally good. Bob Harris, we've got a lot of stuff in the archive because he followed Queen round America in 77.
That's right, yeah.
And filmed everything. And really great stuff.
Whoa. That's the sort of stuff you want to hear.
Some of that we saw at the London Stormtroopers Stilettos exhibition last year.
We did. Some interviews with Roger, wasn't it, mainly?
There's all sorts
of
stuff.
No, at the Stormtroopers thing, it was... There's definitely those
Bob
two together at the kitchen table, wasn't it?
Yeah, but Bob interviewed all four of them and the road crew. He filmed backstage meetings. He filmed them in the dressing room before the gig and after. Walking from the dressing room to the gig, his crew filmed the stage, all around the stage. So, for example, there's footage of somebody standing right behind Roger during the show when Ratty is doing all the dry ice.
Oh, right.
It's astonishing footage. Oh. And some of that we'll see the light of day. And the sound check, of course, with Freddie playing drums.
What was the great line that John Lennon said about Ringo's not even the best drummer in the Beatles?
Somebody asked Paul McCartney. No,
not suggesting that Freddie was a better drummer than Roger.
Asked John Lennon, didn't they? Who's the best? Who does he think Ringo's the best drummer in the world? Yeah, because he's not even the best drummer in the world.
Bless him. Love Ringo.
But nobody has ever said. Let me stress right now the same thing about any member of Queen.
Well, they weren't in the Beatles.
Let's get our employment sorted.
So, what are your next plans for Queen? And any other projects you got coming up?
Rainbow, intermittently, looking after all the tapes mostly. And the other thing I'm doing, kind of a tangent to Queen, but not official as it were, not yet anyway, is a YouTube channel which we've already mentioned on some of the forums called...
Oh, we've announced this, haven't we?
But yeah.
We're working,
it's called
Rare
Share.
What does that entail for those people who...
Well, this is where we're hoping that fans will follow our lead, because we've made some films ourselves of Queen rarities. So if you've got a particular Queen rarity or your favourite Queen thing, whether it's a t-shirt or a box set or some obscure thing from Japan or Korea, doesn't matter what it is, you would make a short film about it at home. You can go into detail and be elaborate, or you can keep it basic. And then you'd send us that footage.
Just so this isn't you going, oh, look at my... a kind of magic CD I bought in HMV.
No,
this
not
is
really.
Kind of real.
It would be, for example, there's things that a lot of fans have never seen up close, like a Japanese Live Killers green red vinyl.
Right, yeah, the real, you know,
really nice things. A lot of stuff that Brian's got, although I'm not using Brian's collection, but I say that because people know what Brian's got because they've seen it at exhibitions. So it's the kind of the fans' equivalent of Brian's phenomenal memorabilia. So if you happen to have a Hangman acetate or a purple vinyl thing that nobody else knows about, or even a, I don't know, a puppet, a Freddie puppet, it doesn't matter what it is, if you think it's of interest to a Queen fan anywhere, then do a film, send it to us, and we'll put it up on Rare Share Queen Collectibles.
I'm sure we'll be covering that off on Queen Online, and we'll tell more about it as and when it all builds and whatnot. So
We're hoping that it will become the place to go for Queen collectors and dealers and experts.
Yeah, for those people who didn't quite understand it when this was put out through a short press release, some people thought it meant we were going to stop putting up demos and unreleased stuff. This is people's own collections,
yes,
talking about their...
It's not me...
key fobs and their badges and their books and, you know...
It's not Greg Brooks, Queen Archivist... No. Going into the archive and showing you and playing you rarities that are not owned by me, but are owned by Queen. You'll hear no Queen music and see no Queen videos on Rare Share. You'll only see rare memorabilia and fans discussing how much that's worth, and did you know there's a pink one of those, and did you know they did those in four types? And
got it.
That's the deal.
Okay, thank you very much, Greg. We're going to sort of wind up there. Be sure to check out all Queen's channels, queenonline.com, facebook.com/Queen, Twitter account too, which is Queen Will Rock. Come along and say hello. Hopefully we'll hear from us again soon. Romantic, can we do it again? Can we do it again sometime? Oh, I like that. Woo-hoo. Seaside rendezvous. Give us a kiss.